Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be visiting the Darfield Earthship and meeting up with Mark, the caretaker, who's going to give us a tour and share his experience living in the Earthship for almost 2 years now. Mark is also a structural engineer who's worked on several Earthships, and in this video he's going to share some really valuable information for anyone thinking of building something similar. So let's go meet up with him and find out more.
One of the nicest things is waking up here quietly on my own with the sun in the summer, and going to sleep with the sun also, and literally just opening my eyes and looking outside at the garden. In the 1960s, 70s, there was an architect named Michael Reynolds down in Taos, New Mexico, who developed this concept of an earthship. Full-blown ones will incorporate water harvesting, will grow food, will deal with their own waste, including gray water, built with natural and recycled materials, will moderate their temperature passively, and also have natural ventilation. My definition of an earthship is kind of anything that incorporates bits and pieces of that, because you see different earthships all over the place, and people have different needs and wants, and they take all sorts of shapes and sizes. The Darfield Earthship is BC's first permitted earthship, and it was built nearly a decade ago and has been occupied the entire time. It was done by a family of five. They used to run an old log building company on site here, so they did their own timber milling themselves and kind of had workshops to come and have people help out. So it's kind of built with their own hands and with the help of a whole bunch of other people also. The owners had an opportunity to move to Toronto and see what living in the city was like, and I've known them for a few years because there's not a lot of structural engineers getting into earthships. And so they asked me if I would caretake it as they kind of explored their next adventure. And I said, yeah, I've been really curious about living rurally, because there's this big romantic idea of what it's like to homestead, and I could actually sink myself into one. I've touched a handful of earthships over the years. So I've been here for about a year and three quarters. I've gone through my first winter and I'm gearing up for the second one. When the owners set out to build this, one of the priorities in mind was to eliminate long-term maintenance costs, and budget and I think finances were firmly set. And so there's a number of things in here that aren't finished 100%, but the thing is totally functional, and the owners are really, really practical people, and I actually really admire them for that. So you'll notice when you first come in that there's these U shapes. So those are car tires packed with dirt, stacked like bricks. And if you arch them like that, then they are stable if they behave as a retaining wall. So what you don't see is that there's actually a whole bunch of soil behind that. So we're semi underground once you step in here. So the house is actually made up of these sort of units of U shapes. So on top of the car tires is a base plaster. It's an earthen plaster, so it's the same mix as a cob. It's a sand, clay, and chopped straw. Usually there would be a finished plaster on top of that, but it hasn't been done yet. The floor is made similarly. It's an earthen floor. So again, same sort of straw, sand, and clay. And in the main room, we've also got a rocket mass heater with its chimney pipe actually kind of going horizontally through the bench. So when you light your fire, the draw kind of goes up and then horizontal with the intention of warming up the bench so that you're not evacuating all the precious heat that you've just generated from the fire. It's probably undersized for this size of house. My guess is it probably makes a degree difference, and in the winter I'll be strategic about compartmentalizing different rooms. When the sun does come up on the days that there isn't all of this low-lying valley cloud, it'll jump up to 24 degrees in here. So I'll be in a t-shirt, sort of midday, and I'll kind of tough that out in an effort to kind of store the heat and make my night a little bit more comfortable. This one actually has a bit of a reveal. So with the intention of allowing some more sort of immediate heat radiate outward, and the rest of it kind of gets stored. One of the issues with it is that you're stuffing it with like 13, 14 inch pieces of wood, and when it draws, it's really roaring, and it's probably only like a 30 minute burn, maybe 40. This is an older variation of an earthship, but we have low lying operable windows there, and in the back of all of the U-shaped modules, we have operable skylights that we can pop open. So when I open those up and open up the doors and the other windows, you can actually feel convective flow going. But like, you can feel the wind going over you just from that ventilation. This earthship doesn't have an overhang on the front, and I think it would be nice to have the temperature be a little bit more manageable and the hot peaks in the summer, and I think an overhang would actually go a long way. There's a bathroom here. There's actually two bathrooms in the earthship. Right now, this is the only one that has a shower in it. It doesn't have finished plasters on it. You can see that it's got pop can and bottle walls, and those should actually be covered with a brown coat, a base plaster, similar to what the tire walls were. And then after that, you could do a finished plaster. This is the guest bedroom. So the guests get a nice big king size bed and room to themselves. And then everything in here is pretty open concept, and that's important in the design of this one for ventilation purposes, because it can kind of get stuffy in here in the winter otherwise, because you tend to want to keep everything closed up. So anyways, I've got these sort of makeshift curtains to partition things off. So this is the kitchen. We have an electric stove, a really fancy hood vent. There's a freezer that was converted into a fridge because its insulation is a little bit beefier. So it's going to be more efficient. And it's also a chest, which means you don't dump all of your cold air out every time you open it. And the back side of it, there's a kind of a cold storage room with a whole bunch of canning supplies, and the freezer is back there. Pantry and whatnot as well. So there's dehydrators and all sorts of stuff. So we have a second bathroom here. A soaker tub is planned to go in, but basically all it has is a toilet and a sink. This is the electrical room. So we've got a panel in there, and then also have like a pressure tank from the well water at the back there. It's wired for AC and DC as far as I know, so it would be easy to switch over when they want to. And then this is the room that I've been in. There used to be two beds in here, and the girls would share this room, but I've been in here ever since. This is where I dry my laundry, because I don't have a dryer. I have a washing machine though. The gray water planter trench continues here. It's along the entire south side of the earthship, and you couldn't get occupancy in the building by just leaving it bare. They hadn't done the gray water planter yet, and they wanted to move in. So a prereq to being able to occupy the building was to board it up so there wouldn't be a fall hazard there anymore. Last year, I actually turned this into a nursery, so I could get a head start on my garden outside. People get into earthships for different reasons. Chris and Sandra, one of their drivers was finances, and they're very practical people. Along the way, there were compromises made. One of them was the siting of this thing. And there was a septic tank there, and there was power running up to here already. There was also pre-existing well water on site because they already had it. So there's all these things that were already in place before they decided to build it, and they used it. So this earthship is on grid. We've got well water, and we're on a septic system, but it's set up and designed so that it could keep on moving forward to becoming like a full-blown earthship. There's an empty trench in the front. It's plumbed, but it's prepared to receive gray water from the bathrooms. The bathrooms are placed up against the windows so that you can gravity feed those intentionally. The roof is set up to collect rainwater. There's plans for cisterns and the drawings. And the electricity grid is right beside the highway. And fortunately in BC, carbon profile on energy is basically zilch out here. It's really, really small. It's not necessarily a lot of bang for your buck to switch over to solar. I think one of the primary functions of an earthship is incorporating passive solar design, which is basically the idea of maximizing your solar gain in the winter months when it's coldest and minimizing your solar gain in the summer months. So you're trying to keep the building warm naturally in the winter and trying to keep it cool naturally in the summer. And it does that by having all of these south-facing windows that are actually angled so that when the sun is the lowest in the winter, the sun rays hit that perpendicular and you're actually getting solar gain pretty much right to the back of the building. You're naturally just collecting all of that in this earthen materials with that radiant energy being stored in it. And today you can actually feel it warmer in the south side than it is in the north side. And behind the car tire walls, we actually have another 4 feet or so of soil before you have insulation. And on the underside of this, there's actually insulation below the earthen slab. So all of that heat comes in, charges that up, sun goes down, and the heat escapes back into the space. Here in Darfield, it's not unheard of for it to be like minus 30 overnight. And we're actually in a bit of a low-lying valley, so we actually don't get a lot of solar gain. I'd say on average in the winter, it's about 16 degrees in here on its own. So what that means is that I can leave for like weeks at a time without worrying about things freezing in here, which is a game changer when you're living rurally. Most passive solar design is done anecdotally. You'll hear people in Earthship land say that an Earthship works absolutely everywhere. And I would say that it works, but maybe not that well in some areas. Like, that's not like a silver bullet solution. And passive solar design is similar. You do need good temperature swing, and you need thermal mass, and you need to orient the thing correctly. But really, the only way to tell is to energy model it, because everybody is in different microclimates. Energy modeling is basically software analysis during the design phase of a building that will predict a particular energy performance of your building. There's some softwares that just look at insulation thicknesses and kind of call it good. There's other softwares that can account for sun angles, microclimates, and then it spits out, you know, whether or not your interior climate and temperatures are appropriate for your area, and you can predict that before you get into construction and take some of the guesswork out. So you could Google energy modelers. There's professionals out there that have these softwares. I've been working with a company called Associated Engineering, and they have like the fanciest energy modeling software out there, and they've been really great to help us understand how these things work. Biggest disadvantage in this thing, I think, is that the rocket mass heater is a pain. which has been interesting because there's a lot of romance around rocket mass heaters as well. But if it's just me and I don't have a lot of sun in the winter, I'm babying that thing quite often, and that eats up a lot of my time. Their original plans had another wood stove in the other side of it as well, so they would have two wood stoves. This came as an afterthought, and they decided to try it out. Another disadvantage, which isn't obvious to me because I'm largely here on my own, but it's very open. And I haven't had an issue with many of my guests, but you can hear everything that's going on all of the time, even if you're in the bathroom. And if you're not comfortable having a shower facing the garden, that can be a bit of an issue. So like, you could put a blind up if you wanted to, but socially it's a bit interesting. A lot of people come here and ask, like, can you even build these? Like, how is this possible? They're illegal, there's so much red tape, they're not code compliant. So a normal prescriptive residence looks like 2x6s at whatever center, you know, put this much insulation in, do this for electrical and plumbing and call it good. As soon as you start going outside of what those are, the building code requires you to bring in registered professionals to take responsibility for each of those aspects. So if you're building with car tires, there's no prescription for how to build with car tires. But the code allows you to retain a structural engineer to design it as a gravity retaining wall. And as long as it can meet the same performance that any other structure would, then you can use it. And that professional takes responsibility for it. Similarly with envelope issues, like using like an earthen plaster or pop bottles or whatever, different insulation materials. If there's no prescription for it in the code, doesn't mean that you can't do it. it means you need to hire somebody to take professional responsibility for it. And so that's either an envelope consultant or an architect. And it can kind of go on and from there, depending on what non-prescriptive systems you're putting in there. So it's really important to equip yourselves with the right people to help you design this. And it's not a one-size-fits-all solution. At the end of the day, it's a custom home. So like, start thinking that you're building a custom home. And if you're really, really savvy and you have the resources and you've got the skill sets required and the right people come into your life at the right time, you might be able to bring that cost down and that effort down. But at the end of the day, you're still building a home, and like a pretty complex one at that, with a lot of systems that aren't off the shelf. If those aren't executed well, then I think you'll have problems, and that could be a really big disadvantage. But just like you're building a normal home, like, you should pay attention to all of those details. One of the coolest and sort of unsuspecting advantages is I've like increased my observation of what's going on outside, because my daily life kind of depends on what the weather is doing. So I'll check to see what the forecast is, and like, I'll open or close the windows, or like, and like, that is just part of my daily pattern and behavior now, which is kind of nice, because I feel like I'm more in tune with what's going on outside. I don't know, it's not a measurable advantage, but I think it's really, really cool.
If you want to get in touch with Mark and find out more about the Darfield Earthship, we'll put links down below in the description. Also, if you're interested in Earthships, we've visited quite a few over the past few years, so you can check out our Earthship video playlist, also linked down below. Please share this video if you liked it, be sure to subscribe, and thanks for watching.